because of the split in the Labour Party, because what Corbyn wants, he wants to stay in the EU in London and come out of the EU in Sunderland.
Well, you never let me finish, but you get the Liberal Democrats, you say he's a complete, he should never vote. Well, as you know, they finished it. Nick Clegg ruined them, and of course they give him a notch, but... And then you've got the Green, haven't you? One, that woman, who again, she wants another vote. What she's got to do with it, I haven't got a clue. And the split, so therefore, this argument could go on for a million years. They need to get into a, like, they need a judge, a proper judge, to, in a courtroom and get them out and say, you've got to come out with a result, and you'd be locked in that bloody room without no food, no drinks, no nothing, till you sort yourselves out, because you're making a mockery of our blinking, our parliament.
You're right there, John.
A disgrace. Roger Cromwell, that's who you want, riding in on his horse and sacked a lot of them.
Yeah. Begone from this place. You have been here far too long for what good you have done.
Hey, you got a horse, John. Couldn't you ride in there?
I'd love to. I'd love the military just to take it over for a week. Get them into rooms. Well, I'd sort him out with that little... That scruffy bird and that silly woman who sits next to him. And the other one sometimes, on the other side of him, like that nodding dog in the back of a car. All she does is that black one with a nodding head. I'd sort them lot out straight away. They'd be out. They wouldn't even be allowed in the parliament. So I'd sort them. The little Scotchman, well... And the other is that bunch. Have you seen them? What a scruffy bunch. I'd take them straight down, even dressing them in burdens, because there's a burdens around the corner. They look better if they was dressed in burdens. So I'd march them out and get them smartened up, get them have a shave and an haircut, and chuck the shirt in the pan, make them stand up properly, clean the shoes, and the women comb their hair. They're a right scruffy bunch.
Yeah. Which one would you make have a military bath?
Yeah?
Which one would you have a military bath?
All the SMPs, but I'd put that stuff in. You remember when we was kids, Tony, in Liverpool, when we in the bombing and that, they used to, them baths, it's all, the nurses used to put you in to get rid of all the lice. You remember that? I'd get them all in there, but I'd put them all in together and put the lid on.
Jesus.
Oh dear.
Do you remember them baths? All them used to sting your eyes.
Oh yeah, with that bloody lysol and that bloody carbolic salt.
And then they put the house pipes on you, wouldn't they, them blinking the sisters?
Oh, I remember the tin bath.
Well, they used to have that one first to get rid of the lice, and then they stand you up, and all the sisters, you know, with a... The nuns used to spray you what a carry-on that was. So you used to think the penguins was attacking you.
I bet Eric never had to go through any of that. Too posh for that.
Lift your hands up, Tony. I'll put a DDT canister underneath.
That stuff they used to... that powder, right dangerous stuff, wasn't it?
Yeah, DDT.
Yeah.
A lot of children when they were fumigating those people coming out of the concentration camps.
And there's a lot of QSB on this band tonight. Is anybody else getting it?
No, I've noticed.
Oh, the signals aren't as good as normal, I don't think.
You're absolutely right, John. There is QSB and signals are down. G0 and EV.
Well, you're very strong. You're 55 over 9 with me, Mike.
It's 20 over with me, Ken. Get a decent aerial.
Strongest signal on band with me.
No, he's strong. Everybody's quite good.
Listen to her again, then. Here's her making comments. She's back making comments, the apprentice.
That's right, isn't it, Ken?
Right, isn't it, Ken?
Oh, dear.
He's beginning to lie. He's being about like that boxer. You know what I mean, Ken?
What's his name now? Black guy, isn't it?
What about that poor footballer signed for Cardiff then and
down in the channel somewhere.
He was ours, wasn't it? So did that Audrey in the island.
Bad dude, I was. Same thing happened to that band leader, Glenn Campbell, but he was going the other way.
No, but the thing, what I can't understand there, it's about 120 miles in a direct line there. Why would he go in a little Piper aircraft like this time of the year with him and the pilot? I just don't get that. Why would he do that? He'd have been better off jumping in his nice car and going on a ferry, wouldn't
he? Yeah. He was flying from a place called Nantes in France, N-A-N-T-E-S, and I know exactly from Nantes in France to where I used to live in Preston. It's exactly 456 miles, that's from a place which we used to send racing pigeons to.
Nantes in France.
Hence, it depends.
He wasn't going to damn Preston.
No, he was going to Cardiff.
Yeah, well, you can work it out, can't you? It's about 200 miles from here to Cardiff.
Oh, God.
Yeah, but...
I told you what it is.
But if you go down, crossing the channel, you're in the water.
Stop doubling.
140-mile flight path, be told.
Oh, well...
Yeah, but I don't know whether he'd be directed mainly over land or what, John.
Well, it's not long before he's overseas there, Ken, and it was... anyway, that's what it was. I don't want to go into turning left and turning right and all that nonsense.
No use asking Eric. He doesn't know how fair Spain is from Gibraltar.
The only thing I was, the comment that I was trying to get through... I didn't want him to talk about going up to Preston or anything like that. I was just... What I was trying to get over it, why would you take a small aircraft this time of the year when he's got about three or four sports cars, that guy has. He could have got in his nice sports car down to the ferry and had something nice to drink while he was going over, but it just seemed strange to me, that business.
Well, you might have thought that's a novelty, flying in a little plane. I'll do that, but I bet he won't now. People wish he hadn't.
It's a horrible thing, of course, but it just seems strange to me why they would do it. Did they have a cab full of Jamaican woodbines? Oh, well, I don't know, but he'll come to light no doubt. But
yeah, well, they wouldn't stand much chance in the channel in this weather.
Well, this is what I'm saying.
Yeah, this time of the year it's a... Well...
It just seems very strange, but anyway, the poor lad looks as though he's took the wrong decision and paid for it.
Yeah.
But wouldn't they still get the 15 million quid back you paid for him?
I don't think they get that till they get play the first game, do they, Ken?
I don't know. No, I suppose the club would take out some insurance on him, but of course it depends. I mean, in that insurance, that might not include travelling on a light aircraft in the winter from the continent to England.
No, but I don't think the transfer money is never paid until they have one game with the company the football team, generally a company, of course, who they've signed for.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's a...
Ronaldo got fined, what, £97 million?
Yes,
who?
the tax evasion, I think.
Oh, what, Ronaldo?
Yeah. I think it was 97 million and a 2-year suspended sentence.
Yeah, he agreed to pay it just like that. Bloody all right, and if you got the money, you can get away with not being sent to prison. The fact that he pulled that kind of a stunt, it's a joke.
Yeah, well, let the Piggott have the money. If he was such a tight bastard, he said, I'm soon to go to jail.
Kane Dog got off with his heart, didn't he? Oh, he can't stand the court, and next minute after the trial, when he got let off, there he was, as bright as a button.
And I used to like old Ken Dad. Ken, did you remember him, Ken Dad? He got the tax man as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what Tony just said. Well, in any case, you see, the club, if Ronaldo was fined, the club would probably pay up.
And they give him a few tickets for a few games.
Yeah.
Anyway, you can't really complain if you think about trying to beat the tax man in Spain. I think it was a Spanish tax man who wanted his money. And they're the biggest crooks in the world.
Yeah. Well, I don't know whether it was Spain or Portugal.
Spain, that he owed the money to.
Didn't they?
No, double there.
I said Arsenal done well. Did Tony congratulate you?
he didn't say anything, John. He never does when we win.
Oh, Preston won 4-1, Queen's Park Rangers.
Oh.
What about, Manchester United and old Solskjaer, he's had 7 games now, undefeated since the special one went. He wasn't special, was he?
Yeah. Well, when he took over at Chelsea, he had a ready-made bloody team, didn't he?
Well, it just shows you, doesn't it? He's, a bloke like Drogba, he had sitting on the bench. I mean, even Paul on 1920 would have had him play it.
Yeah.
And he put Jolly goal.
And now he's scoring.
Where's he gone to now? Some
French team, is it? Or...
Oh, has he got a new job, has he?
I'm not sure. I don't know what's happened to him. The papers are not publishing much about him.
Oh, you'll have to ask John in Ireland here. He probably knows.
I can't be bothered to go down on the 20. I'll send Tony Preston down.
We can ask him when he comes up.
Last time you sent me down there, the bloody suicide vest didn't work.
These lads who disfigured the statues and the memorials. Could you give them a run on exploding vests? I've always wanted to see, you know what I'd love to have seen, you know, the instructor, you know, when he's teaching these boys, you know, he'd say, now watch very closely, lads, because I'm only going to show you these ones.
So, what's happened to your old mate then? Can't he take it on here now then, John? Is he getting past it?
No, well, he might be doing other things. I'm sure he's listening. He could be rolling out a new rig. I can remember a few years ago, he rolled a rig out in about a week.
Yeah.
I know what to do with him. I know what to do with him, Basildon.
I reckon that rig he made is a bird's nest and he's too ashamed to show us.
No, I know what's wrong with Eric.
What's that? Well, you do have a shave for a start off.
Well, what happened? These dogs, his daughter has the muck on his lawn, and he goes round putting little stakes in where the muck is such for so his daughter can pick it up. But one of them's had diarrhoea, and he's been doing it for the last 3 days now.
So
he's a
scooper boy then?
No, he doesn't pick it up. He has these little, you know what they do in minefields? He has a little, little stakes, little bits of cane with flags on. And when he finds a bit of dog muck, he sticks it up the side of it so his daughter knows where it is.
Well, it's not like he does a lot during the day, is it, that he couldn't do it? Become a shit picker.
Poor temperatures, cold air, can at the moment. 9 below.
Good
is
God.
It really? No, it's just holding 0.3 below here.
No, sorry. It's 0.9 below.
Yeah, same here, John, exactly the same here. Did you get any snow?
Yes, about half past five. It happens like a blizzard coming down, return to rain.
That's what I told Ken was happening here, but he said he didn't have it, much snow.
It's
not half an inch on the bins, Tony, and I can still see the grass through it.
Very black over the Bell's mums, and he'd really opened up, and if he'd have carried on like that, you'd have had 6 inches in no time, but a bit of rain came straight after, and not on the ground at the moment, just scattered a bit, you know. But.
Well, we've just had the odd sort of light shower. There's been nothing else, John.
I was going out to get fish and chips, and I thought, nah, it's bloody stupid going out at night like this. It's snow, and it's
probably frozen, and that'll be as slippery as anything.
As soon as you said fish and chips, then my stomach started to growl.
I really fancied them, but I wouldn't drive us about a mile and a half, 2 miles to go and get them.
But just eat some fish and chips.
Yeah.
How's your taste now, John, your smell? Is it getting any better?
No. No, it's better than it was, but it would never get right now, will it? I'll just accept it in there.
Yeah.
Your sense of smell and taste tend to go off as you get older, because I can always remember this, I've mentioned it before, with my old chap. He used to Sunday dinner with the old roast beef and that. He always used to moan bloody tough, no flavour to it.
Yeah, I've noticed that, Ken. It's though like they're taking the sugar out of things, but perhaps it's just my age then.
Well, yeah, I think you do tend to lose the senses a bit.
If you can't smell, you can't taste. It's just simple as that. Your nose is the most important.
Yeah. I mean,
and of course, when you fight, you can't smell it, you know, you're
in trouble.
You're in
trouble eating
another his
waistcoat. Stop doubling, Ken. Oh, what blame me? Well, you and Tony have been doubling all night long.
Yes.
Use your Vox.
I am on Vox.
Well, get your delay sorted out then, or try and draw for it.
That's immediate.
That's right, isn't it, Ken?
Yeah.
He doesn't come on for a bloody fortnight, and he's telling everybody what to do.
Well, someone needs to take charge on here. You're not grown up enough for it, are you?
Ooh. Is it what you want?
No, not really, Tom, no. You're too smart for me.
wonder if they ain't had any snow. Did you have any snow here?
I think he's still trying to sort his audio out, John.
Good nasty man.
He's got trouble then, Tony. Has he got rigor mortis?
Well.
He's a nasty man, isn't he, Ken?
Yeah. I'm going to slip away for a while and go and get a drink.
Do you know what the temperature is here?
Well, you haven't told us.
2 degrees.
Remember the 3 degrees?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's dropping fast here now. It's gone to 2.
Very cold here in the country.
It's not freezing here. It feels quite warm. I think it's because we're nearer the sea.
Well, it will be. You're always at the temperature's always up a bit by the sea, of course. That's why you don't get a lot of snow, of course, but where I am, it's, well, you know where we are, right in the middle. The historic cool centre of England, where I am.
That's where all the troublemakers are.
You're right. Well, we got all the castles around us, surrounded by castles.
Strange ways.
And moats. Knights in armour.
Has anyone heard from the grand land grabber in Wales?
Well, generally Mike would give you information on that.
Ah. Who's that keep? Or someone there. Is that Barry?
I see that the Duke's got a new lander at Range Rover there.
Oh, don't you start me on that. Daft old sod shouldn't even be on the road.
Well, he's called himself a fool, didn't he, in the newspaper?
Yeah. At that age, John, you know, you can't be that safe at 90. There's very, very few people that would be safe at that age driving.
You talk for yourself. You talk for yourself.
Well, if the Duke wants to drive at 97, he's entitled to drive at 97.
I mean, even old Eric now thinks that's the missus drive because he's not up to it.
Oh, you're asking for it.
Now, he comes out with some old tosh he does. He says, all them dents, he blames his missus, but I reckon it's the other way round personally, but he'll never admit it, will he, Tone?
Oh, I'm putting all this down on paper, I'm a finish on my board.
What's that going on? Standing orders, John?
It is, it's all up there.
Well,
you know, when he comes into the guard room, it'll be read out to him.
Is Colchester Corrective Establishment still going?
Oh, yes.
They are, Tony.
Everybody at double time, just the same.
Yeah.
They were mad to me somewhere. the only British soldier to be convicted of war crimes. It was all right, Donald. We spent many a night here.
I was at a march at double time with a prisoner.
Yeah. Oh, I mentioned it before, didn't I? But my late brother-in-law, when he got there, he said, gosh, we all doubled.
Escort the lot.
Right, boys, I'm feeling tired. I'm going to make a move. Lovely to hear you all. Take care in your endeavours, and hopefully, well, you never know. The old boy might wake up and come on and give us 10 minutes tomorrow.
Yeah, so how are you getting on? You've been obviously been playing with the radio today, listening and playing around with it. So, how do you think you're getting on with it?
Yeah, no, that's where I'm getting on with it, much better than I thought it was. It's not over manually, or the manual menu system is not complicated, John, if you know what I mean.
Well, once you've got them set, of course, you don't have to do a lot, but you can play around. What you want to do, you're smart, you don't do a lot of CW, well, you don't do any, but you can... You listen on the GX and play around with them filters, because you can set the filters. I think there's 10 in each setting that you can use, isn't there? So there's quite a few there, and I'll tell you what, you can use them. Sometimes to go really tight in, of course, you'll get that bit of distortion, but you'll find that you'll be able to hear that call sign, whereas with it wide open, you can't.
Yeah, I've already found that, John, that I'm hearing a lot more than I would have normally heard.
Very good.
Ken? Yes, Ken?
Yes? Yeah, you in RAF. I think I told you before.
Your picture it out, a few photographs when we found it in RAF, right? And it sat in front of a Lancaster bomber. There's about five rows, he sat on chairs, and the ones behind him stood up. There must have been, I don't know, I mean, a few hundred men, it looked a hell of a lot. And he sat on a chair in front, bang in centre, and he has, I don't know what rank he was, but he had a swagger stick, and so I don't know what that the warrant office or something like that. And then he come back over, come back, and he'd been demoted back right down to the bottom again. And I never found out what happened. He never told my mother what happened. So I don't know what he bloody done.
Well, I wouldn't have a clue.
What would you get demoted down your rank for, John?
Well, there's all manner of things, isn't there? You just can't guess, can you? It could be anything from... I'm talking back to an officer minor. I don't suppose the rap is that as strict as the guards and what have you, but it could be in numerous things. He could have been nicking in the nappy, nicking all the blinking fags.
Yeah, nicking the petrol.
Yeah.
Well, knowing him, I reckon that he was actually, I think, from what he was, I reckon he was probably knocking off the commanding officer's way.
Well, he'd have been moved somewhere else then, though, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Probably find that. Ken's probably used it on the end, knocking the petrol off.
Yeah. Oh, we had a bloody police sergeant. He was a bastard. And he got his right desserts. He used to run around in, what were they, 300-weight trucks or whatever. 300-weight, I don't know. But he got caught nicking petrol. I don't know what happened to him, he just disappeared.
There you get a box of swan matches and light one up right by his face when he's been sucking on the hose.
His name was Smith, Sergeant Smith.
Signals are coming up again now.
I always remember him because you know, when you had a guard duty to do, whichever, if that was fire picket or whatever it was, and yet the name was called out on works parade, you had to go and sign the book up at the
because the like the gate house was not at the gate. The main sort of station was Christ, that was about 3/4 of a mile from our living quarters. They obviously had a gate with the police on, the station police, but you had to go and sign up there. And as I went in to sign, I bumped into this bloody sergeant, and I was coming round the corner. He stopped, he said, "You haven't shaved this morning." I said, "I have." He said, "No, you haven't. Come back at 6 o'clock, shave tonight." So I had to trundle all the bloody way up there at 6 o'clock. He wasn't even there. The good old days.
Well, if I was there, I'd have left you a note on the door to go back and have another one.
Oh, I got there and the corporal, I said, "I've got to see Sergeant Smith tonight shaved." "Well, he's not here," he said. "Yeah, okay."
"Did you about the fella that walked it there, Bruce?" He says, "How much is a shave?" He says, "2 bob. He says, "How much is an haircut?" He says, 3 and 6. He says, "Shave me out."
Well, I'm going to shave my head now and dive into my cut. So, see you later, boys. G3 really, really might.
Cheers.
Okay. No, no, John.
Look at the time. What's that? Basil and John? No, John's gone. There's only you and I, Tony.
I think Mike's still there and the mall will be hiding somewhere.
Yeah, and I was going to add to that, that the mall will be about and so will Mike. Unless he's fallen asleep.
No, no, no. I don't have much to add.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned, the bastards should all be shot.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, Mike, the bloody rig, since he got that new rig and what have you, and got it all set up again, it certainly sounds well. It's really good audio and good signal. You know, you're back on the top of the pile.
Thank you, sir.
I wonder what he's after, Mike.
I haven't got it.
Yeah. He heard you gave away amplifiers, you see.
Yes, actually, Fred is fractionally, and I mean fractionally, better at the moment, but that doesn't mean to say he'll stay that way.
Oh, well, I hope he's improving all the time.
That's not the case.
It's like poor old Dine, David Derrick. She's much a stalemate.
Yeah. Well, my opinion of the medical profession is they're a load of paper-pushing pracks.
Well, I wouldn't... Well, I can't agree with that. I found they've been quite good.
They don't know their arse from their elbow. They're guided by the pharmaceutical companies, and that's that.
Well, I can't say that, like, because the stuff, I'd have been said 10 times over me, only for medical profession.
Well, that's my opinion, and I'm not changing it.
No.
I'm talking about the hospitals and the surgeons, but I don't know what they're like today because I'm going back to 40s and 50s, like, you know.
The surgeons are no more than bodily mechanics. They know all, apart from the diagrams and making a complete mess up of things from time to time,
and finding out, oh, I shouldn't have done that.
Is that what happened with Basil then? That'll bring him back on again.
No, I think not. He'll be tucked up in his little wooden pit.
Yeah.
Well, that's best place.
I always said about our friend Tony and Basil that it was one of the early experiments into test tube babies that went horribly wrong.
Yeah, I suppose I could say that if the doctor hadn't have got me into hospital and then hadn't have operated straight away, I might have gone when I was 15.
Yeah. Appendicitis?
Yeah. Well, if they don't get to it, when it comes on suddenly like that and that burst, you can soon get peritonitis.
Yeah. Well, the daughter-in-law, it did burst. She was in hospital, and, you know, actually, appendicitis is one of the easiest diagnostic things out. A decent doctor will press on it, and it doesn't hurt, and as soon as he takes his hand off and releases it, you get a sharp pain. And it's a classic diagnostic for appendicitis. And they had her in hospital 3 days trying to find out what was wrong with her. Eventually, they took her down to the theatre, cut her open, and they actually had to leave her there in the operating theatre open and rush another, because it was too far gone, they had to rush another specialist from another hospital to sort it out.
Good God. When I was in a doctor came round at 2 o'clock. He said, that looks like definitely appendicitis, he said, but I'll come back later. He didn't come back till the evening. And he said, right, that's it. Phoned up, the ambulance was there straight away. We got a local ambulance, a St John's thing. They whipped me off and operated on me straight away. And when I lay there was a chap in the bed, not opposite, he was sort of diagonal across from me. He'd burst and they cut him open right the way up his tummy and had to swab him out.
Yeah. Oh, it could be nasty. One of the funniest things I had when wife had the last youngster at home, and I phoned midwife up and she come round and she won't have it till tomorrow. He said, and she gave me these tablets. And she says, give her these and it'll bring her on for tomorrow. Anyway, an hour later, she had to pull midwife back up and she had the child. And she says to me, I'm glad them tablets work. I still had them in my hand.
Yeah, my poor old granddad, he was only 73, and they rushed him out, it was too late. He'd got colitis and a burst, peritonitis set in, and boom, he'd gone.
Sounds like that's like a burst ulcer.
Yeah, that was 1943. The local naval doctor went round to see him.
They're no better today than they were then. Yeah. The only advantage that they've got today is electronic scans, etc.
When I had that do, like, I was lucky then, because the both of the doctors that were there, Garden and Cavell, two orthopaedic specialists, were, they'd been at war and treating, you know, gunshot wounds and what have you, and they had a good idea to sort it out. Well, I can't grumble because I'd also, as I told you before, when I was a kid, half a dozen things that kill moths. Would do all killer diseases, but I'm going to pull through, much to the bloody annoyance of people listening on the band these days.
Yeah, bloody hell. Scarlet fever.
Well, diphtheria, scarlet fever, all sorts of bloody pneumonia, quite double pneumonia as they call it, all sorts of bloody things wrong. Now, a bit of a runk, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, oh yeah. I had pneumonia. I can remember the district nurse, I suppose it was, who used to come in and put a whole poultice on me bloody back.
Yeah. Bloody red hot curling poultices. And I got that what? I got that Asian flu in 1957, and they talk about that bird flu, and I think there was about 40 odd in England. 1957, the Asian flu killed over 10,000 people in England. There were actually two. My mate's dad died with it just up the road from us, and another chap down the road, and they were only in their 40s. And they both died with that outbreak of that Asian flu.
Well, I can't remember that. I don't think I got it. I remember Asian flu, but it didn't affect me.
Well, it didn't affect me. Me still here, and I had it, but I've never had flu since. I've never had a flu jab, I've never had flu since, I very seldom get a cold. I think once you've had that, you become immune to it.
Yeah, I don't get a cold very often. Well, I try to avoid people.
My parrot makes me laugh. If I go across to it and start coughing, it starts sneezing.
Oh dear. Now I am.
Funny how Bob hasn't been on tonight.
No. Hey, normally calls in, don't
he? Yeah. I hope his complaints haven't been backlight, because where he was going a few weeks ago, I reckon he'd have been more thorough.
When he passed it over, he'd have signed it straight by, wouldn't he?
I'll tell you what, Ken, you've got to have a laugh on this net. You really, you shouldn't say anything, because by God, you know what we did with his well and his land grabbing and something and other. If you mention anything on here, any ailment or weakness, you've had it.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Did you hear what John said? He said, I'll come and blow your other effing leg off, didn't he?
Yeah. Oh, dear. Yeah, you just... You could have been the legless digger driver.
Yeah. That'd be out and about all day.
Yeah. Really called you Tony Barder.
Yeah. Somebody sent me, my mate sent me that thing of that bigger driver that didn't get paid or something, and he went up them steps and smashed the whole place with his little mini digger. I don't know whether you saw it on the news.
And I saw it in the paper.
He sent me this email. I was in the Tony. I sent one back. I said, good God, Neil. I said, when I were working in construction industry, that was a weekly occurrence. I asked him about a dozen times. You know, there's one thing, you don't get a wrong side of digger driver here. One bloke, he had an argument with his foreman, and he bloody flattened the offices. There were big, bank of offices, site cabins, and he smacked everyone, flattened the bugger things to the ground.
Good John.
Regular that with bigger drivers. I was just saying to Mike, before you come on, I felt that well, I couldn't believe how fit I felt like, you know, fittest I felt for ages, you know. I don't know whether it's weather, you know, but I felt bloody well that today. And I said to him, funny thing that, my grandfather said that day before a day.
Cheerful, it keeps you going.
I'm not joking, Kendall, but I'm not pulling a leg, but I've never felt right over the years, you know, aches and pains and bad backs and rheumatism and joint trouble. And I used to think, bloody hell, if I'm like this when I was in my 20s, I used to get pains in my back, and only way I was sit up carefully in front of fire and burn the bar with heat on fire. You know, it must have been some sort of fibromyalgia or something. And I think, Jesus Christ, if I feel this like when I was 20, what am I going to feel like 30 then? He went on, if I feel the bad as this when I'm 30, feel like when I'm 40 and now, feel less like when I'm 70, what am I going to feel like when I'm 80?
Well, yes, it's some days one feels better than others. Sometimes I get up and I hop around there, I wouldn't know I'd got any problems with my knees. And then later on I think, oh Christ, I have.
Tony is on one leg at a time.
Hello, Bob. We were saying we hadn't heard you.
Well, I've been about, but I've been doing other things.
Yeah. Well, I said the other week when you had your problem, if you signed, you'd sign Stroke Mobile.
Yeah, I didn't have time for the...
You see, Tony, Bob has turned up.
Yeah, funny that. I said to him, I said he was in the great run. He was the only bloke that passed Mo Farah.
Yeah. The other one to come on now is Ian.
He's too busy in shorthand, ready to report everything to the old man of the Isle of Wight.
Much change in her. She was in today and sitting there, but she, her memories, her short-term memories, not too good.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. Well, my memory's not too good anyway. I can never remember what I've had for breakfast, let alone what I had an hour ago.
Yeah, well, that's what I said to her. When you get old, you forget what happened earlier in the day.
Yeah.
Any time.
Yeah. My memory's always been like that. I remember a mate of mine once, Ken, he said, what about that money you owe me? I said, what do you mean? He says, that fiver I lent you when you were drunk. I said, do you not remember when you were drunk and I give it you back?
Yeah.
From Fred, I wonder how he is. Is it moving or not too good?
Well, Mike's the informant on that, and
hey there, Mike. No, he must have gone. What Mike said, he said he spoke today or something, and he said a little bit of a minute improvement, very little.
Well, that's it. I promised Anne I would not discuss it, apart from saying there has been a slight improvement.
Thank you for that, Mike. But you obviously can't hear me. Anyway, carry on, gents.
No, you're a good signal, Bob. Yeah, you carry on if you've something to say. We'll not be stopping all that much longer, but nice to you anyway.
Yeah, it's a good signal here. That's Mike, he's tone deaf or selectively deaf or something deaf.
Have you got any rain up there, Ken?
No, we had some snow, Bob.
Yeah. Nothing else, drizzle. But no snow, no nothing. Other than it's just drizzling away out there. But last night, when I went to bed, it was just starting to rain, apparently. I mean, I didn't hear it, but the wife said it absolutely threw it down during the night. But when I got up in the morning, it wasn't raining. But tonight, it's not raining as such. It's that fine drizzly rain. But we've had no snow whatsoever.
Oh, well, we had a little bit of snow. Not half an inch of it. I don't know what it's turned to now. I shouldn't think it's gone because that's below zero. So, no, it's still on that. But you can see the grass sticking through it.
No,
there's just a very light...
Nothing here, Ken. Nothing at all.
Yeah, very light covering. They had forecast that, in fact, when Diane and Derek were in here this afternoon, I said, it's going to snow. It says on my phone, 5 o'clock, snow. So they waited. You know, he was counting it down for half a minute, 15 seconds, 5 seconds, and he opened the door, he said, it hasn't started, you're wrong. I can't remember what time. I can't remember what time it started. But there wasn't that much.
But we certainly had nothing here, nothing at all, only a little bit of rain.
Ah.
It was snowing about it was snowing quite heavy a couple of times today. Really big flakes they were, but they weren't sticking.
Yeah.
When you think about it, me and Ken are not that far apart, really, not in a straight line. You know, all right, it's quite a long old journey by road, but, take a straight line is not very far. We've had no snow, but not even one flake. So there you are.
Well, Eric and Whiskey Mike are not all that far apart, are they?
No.
only a couple hundred miles.
Yeah. Must be a long piece of string that joins them together.
Well, I don't reckon Eric had anything.
They seem to be quite comfortable on the Isle of Wight as far as where they go. I'm taking it, if Bob didn't have snow, then certainly the Isle of Wight didn't have it.
I keep forgetting, whereabouts is Bob?
Paddock Wood.
Go again, Bob, whereabouts?
In the Garden of England, Paddock Wood.
That's good.
We're in Paddock Wood, near Maidstone. There you are, Tony.
Yeah, Maidstone, Kent, Kent.
Yeah. Other side of the river to me.
What's that town? My son bought some at once. I don't know if they were a car or something. And he went down to pick it up. Is it Bright Sea or something like that? The Bright Mech or something?
I wouldn't know.
What town's in Kent that is Bright? I think it's B-R-I-G-H-T, Bright something?
Well, it could have been Brighton.
No, not Brighton. He don't go to Brighton. Jesus Christ, Bob.
Well, it's not that far away.
No, it's down on south east somewhere. Something Bright, Britain.
Well, Ken would know more about that. He lived in one of them places.
What is it, Ken?
Well, I was on the east coast up at Brightling Sea, but that wouldn't be there. I wouldn't know, Tony.
I know he drove down once to pick something up and it's down southeast, and I'm sure, I might be wrong, I'm sure it's something bright, something like that. It's quite a biggish place.
Oh, that wouldn't be Brightling, see, that's only here. Oh, it might be of a population of 6,000 now, but it was always about 5,000. Otherwise, no, I wouldn't know, Tom.
I'll have to ask him, and I'll let you know if I can remember. Basildon's been on, and Whiskey Mike, and Mike, and myself, and Ken. Who else has been on?
Oh, I can't remember.
And you had Blakey on tonight. He normally comes on.
No, he didn't turn up.
Busy making effigies of Basildon and sticking pins in them.
I'll tell you what, Tony, it was on the news yesterday, I think it was. Well, I don't know about on the news, it was, but did you see that horse race where that jockey, he went over the last jump, and he more or less fell off the horse. He was hanging on, and he was underneath the neck of the horse, and there the hell he did it, I don't know. He hung on, he managed to get back on the top, because he was in front, and then he got behind, but after he got back on the top, he galloped away and managed to win.
No, I didn't see that. I didn't see that. I didn't. I haven't bothered. I haven't been. I'm big.
haven't bothered going down the last couple of days. I went down tonight. There were night racing at Newcastle, and I put a bet on tonight racing tonight, and I won a few quid, not much, like, you know, more or less double mistake I put on. But I haven't had a bet since Saturday, so I won't bother watching racing. Bob?
Yeah, okay, Tony. It was, you know, it's all good to the guy. I mean, he went over the last jump and he came off and he was hanging underneath the net. How he kept his feet in the stirrups, I don't know, but somehow he managed to get himself back up onto the top of the horse, and he was about three lengths behind the other guy, but over the next sort of 25 yards, he managed to get in front and win by about four lengths.
I'll see if I can find it after. I'll find it after. Mind you. And, you know, they're doing about, well, flat horses do about 40, but they're going a good 30 mile an hour over bloody jumps. I suppose he didn't want to drop off.
I can't see anything with them.
Before, but, you know, if you can find it, it would be really interesting to you.
It's Podium, Benenden, Benenden, all in Kent, Tony. I can't see other. There's another one up on the coast, out towards Margate, which is Birchington on Sea, Broadstairs, of course. So you'll have to ask your boy.
I think it is. All that Southern Tuesday falls off YouTube. That's 8th of December. Jockey's pants fall down during race. Jack Kennedy, 7th of December. I'll put the date in. Was it yesterday or today?
Was it yesterday or today, Bob?
No, I think it was yesterday or the day before.
Yesterday or the day before. Hang on a minute. Oh, so it could have been Monday or Tuesday, Tony.
I found it. It was today. It doesn't show it on YouTube. I'll have to check it. Michael Sweeney tumbled from Askeddy on the final fence, clinging onto the horse's neck. He managed to swing back into saddle and rode to victory.
Yeah, that's right, Tony, but you want to actually see it, and it's fantastic.
Yeah, I can see it.
Okay, I'll keep quiet then. Places you mentioned, Ken, they're fine, but they're not very big places, are they? Not what Tony's saying.
The only other one, what about Broadstairs? Is that big or not?
No, that's not big either, is it? It's only, you know, like the coastal towns up round your area.
I wouldn't know. He'll have to ask his boy.
I'll tell you, it wasn't hanging on for so long. It soon swung itself back on, didn't it, within a few strides?
Yeah, but he must have been a clever guy to do it than to hang on and get back up like that. I don't know how he managed it, but you probably do.
Yeah. Mind you, as I said, like, you know, where the horse is, if he'd have let go, the horse would have galloped over the top of him, wouldn't it? An horse will try not to stand on you. You see him fall off and over the ears, and there's a big pile-ups and falling all over the floor, but it's very seldom that the horse actually stands on you. Even if you fall off, if they stand on you, it's completely by accident, because they try not to stand on you, you know.
I wouldn't know, Tony. I'm not an horse person.
I've never fallen off, actually. I've been lucky.
I've fallen off.
Pardon?
I've fallen off.
My lad's fallen off 3 or 4 times, and daughter, but I've never fell off.
I fell off 3 times.
I didn't think you'd do riding.
No, well, it was once we went out, that was when Jackie used to play badminton, and a lot of her friends, we'd all like to ride a horse, so there was a place over... Hadley, is it? It's called Belfairs, and they rent out horses you can ride. And the thing was, they've got these quick release stirrups or whatever, and I put my foot, but I triggered it, and as I put my weight on, there was nothing there, and I just fell off. At the other times, well, one I didn't fall off, I was sitting on one of the Jackie's riding gelding, bareback, and coming through the woods, a branch went down. I was sort of ducking down, but the branch went down, that was a semi-dead thing, went down the back of me bloody jumper that I'd got on. I didn't fall off. I said, whoa, yeah, stop him, quick. And the other time I did, I was sitting on there, and she was just walking with him. I said, it's a bit tame. So she got him to trot, and I was bouncing up and down, holding on his mane. I thought, I might pull that, and he might not like it. So I let go, and I just bounced down the back and went off the end.
I've never rode. I wouldn't attempt to ride bareback.
I'm off to me bed, gentlemen. Catch you another night. Cheers.
Yeah. Okay, no, Bob.
Yeah. Well, I think I'll pack up as well, if you don't mind, Ken. It's nearly 8:30.
Yeah, that's okay. I was just going to say that. I've got a glass here with about 3/4 of an inch of beer in it, and I was just going to swig that back and say I'm going. So that's all right. I've turned not all the heat off, but that 3 kilowatt thing I've turned off. I didn't want cold feet.
3 kilowatts? Jesus Christ, you're splashing out, aren't you?
Yeah, I run that thing to warm the place up, and I'll keep it if I want to warm my feet up. I can't take it with me, Tone.
Oh, bloody hell, I never thought of that. Is that long since I used it? Oh, I have a radiator up wall here. It runs off electricity. It's a little tiny oil field one. I come out of a caravan. And in winter time, I always switch it off. I'd forgot completely about it. I've been using a little little electric fire here. It's one of them with tubes in, whatever they call them, iridescent or something. And I never thought about the radiator. First time I switched it on this winter.
Yeah, I've got a small one. I don't know what kilowatt it is. It's a little oil filled thing. I know, it's in the conservatory. I've got very little space in here, and if I have that in and other things, it's, I mean,
room to move about.
So I've got this, I bought a damn great 3 kilowatt fan heater. And,
You don't want to bother with them. They make them fan heaters. They make the place stuffy. This one I've got here, it's just got 2 boys on. But what do they call it? It's not like the old wire-wound boys. They're like glass tubes inside. What do they call them?
What, are they a tubular heater, are they?
Yeah, they glow red. The tubes are... The glass, like, they have a name for them. What the hell do they call the things?
Don't know. I'm trying to think what shack it was where I had some tubular heaters. You used to get them, mate. Oh, they came in various lengths, I think, from about 2 foot, 4 foot, 6 foot, 8 foot long. And they were about 2 inches in diameter. You had brackets, you could fit them to the wall. I'm trying to think which shack I had those in. That must have been the one at Ashington.
Oh, no. Know what you mean? These are not like that. They're only about 9 inch long, and there's 2 of them, and the thing stands up, and you can have it at 1 bar on it too. And they're like a little, about 9 inch by about 1/2 inch across, a little glass tube. But they have a name for the bloody tubes, and I just can't think what they're called.
Infrared, don't it?
Infrared, that's it, yeah.
Yeah,
John.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Oh, blimey.
You're right. Modern stuff.
They're only about 20 quid or something like that. You want to get yourself one, they're absolutely cracking. Much better than that fan heater.
Oh, I don't know. I've got the heat pump. That's the cheapest one to run. 2.5 kilowatt, and only 600 or 700 watts in. I've turned the fan heater off. The trouble is that it's all hot up top.
Well, I mean, have a fan
what is it in here? 26.8 in here. 27 on the over there near the wall. But it'll be a lot colder down low.
Are you all right, John? It's Whiskey Hotel Alpha. It was John that called in then, weren't he?
I don't know.
That was me, don't it?
Yeah, who's that?
That was me. You know me.
Oh, it's Pete. I thought it was the guy from the North East. I thought it was a nice one. I thought it was John. I can't tell the difference between a bloody a Geordie accent and a flipping Irish accent. Are you okay, Rod?
I'm very best, Tony, and you're sounding good.
Yeah, I was just saying, I feel bloody fit today. I felt better than I've felt in for a long time.
Very good, that's great. Hope it keeps up.
No, as I said to Kenneth, as my grandfather said that just before he dropped dead.
I was going to ask him if he'd won the lottery or bloody one of them horses. But he said he felt good.
Yeah. Well, I didn't know. I felt good before I put that bet. I entered the bet since Saturday. We have to go down to the shop and and it bit bookies, and I put 3 quid on, and I looked on racing on thing, and I did a forecast up, and on one race, you pick first and second, and I'm about 15 quid to come back tomorrow.
Oh. Well, you said you were going, and it's now gone 1:30, so I am.
Yeah. Well, I'll just have a quick word with Rod, and then I'll be off. All right, good night, Ken.
Night-night. Tony, Rob, everybody, G4KDH signed. Oh, and Mike, of course, mustn't forget him.
Yeah, well, the mall hasn't called in tonight.
No.
KMEI2KD.
DG1YHA, Germany.
There you are, Charlie always calls in when I've signed, doesn't he?
Yeah, hello. Good night, Ken.
No, no, Charlie. G4KDH gone.
Yeah. What? Hey, good evening, Charlie. Was that you, Ian? Oh, somewhere, I thought Ian called me. What's the weather like in the Emerald Isle, Rod?
Cold, Tony. There's a slight skift of snow, and that's been hanging around all day, so there could be more coming tonight.
We'll probably get that tomorrow. It's 2 degrees here outside, according to weather forecast. It's still, you know, so it's not freezing.
Yeah, well, it's 1.5 here. 1.5, so it's just about freezing. It's been a bit cooler the last couple of nights.
Anyway, I'll just pop it over to Charlie, and are you all right, Charlie?
Yeah, we are lucky here. It started to snow in the western part of Germany, but not here. So not one flake is coming down. Pretty cold, minus 10 degrees, but lucky. We have no snow, actually.
Look, minus 10? Jesus Christ.
Yeah. It's pretty chilly here.
Do you hear that? Minus 10, Rob.
Yeah, I hear that, Tony. I wonder what sort of a heater he's got.
He doesn't need an heater. Charlie, he has some young ladies. I think he's the only fella I know that's got 3 or 4 girlfriends, so he shouldn't have any trouble keeping warm.
It keeps warm, dancing.
That's it.
How many hours today, Charlie?
Every day between 3 and 7 hours.
Oh, my goodness. You hear that, Tony? Dancing, dancing, dancing.
I know. I suppose it's better than rabbiting away on the radio.
What was it today, Charlie? Was it tango or some of those fancy steps?
Kind of dancing, Charlie.
Oh, it's ballroom. Ballroom dancing, standard Latin. It's salsa, modern jazz, and tango as well. It's Argentine tango as well. So, but mostly Latin.
There you are, Rod.
Yeah, sounds good. Latin American, Charlie.
Yeah. What is what?
Do you not do the waltz? You know, the Viennese waltz.
Certainly. But you don't dance it in England.
Yeah, of course you dance the waltz. Every year it's quite common.
A slow waltz is common in England, but in Blackpool they strictly deny any kind of Viennese waltz.
Well, I didn't know that.
Yeah, the English people, they claim that the Viennese waltz does not belong to the standard ballroom dances. But the rest of the world does.
Yeah. Blackpool's only about 10 miles away from me by, as the crow flies, but it's about 15 miles by road.
Yeah. The Winter Garden, that is the mecca in ballroom dancing, and one of my best friends, he is a double world champion, and he won 2 times in Blackpool.
We used to go all the time when we were first married and take the kids out for a day on the beach and the fun gardens and into the winter gardens. And they used to have a zoo, you know.
It wasn't really nice on the animals, but underneath the tower, underground, they had a zoo, did lions and tigers. There used to be a rhyme, I can't say it so much. In the seaside, can you hear me, Charlie?
Yes, I can.
In a seaside town called Blackpool, noted for fresh air and fun, Mr. and Mrs. Ramsbottom took Albert, their son. A grand little chap was Albert, all dressed in his best quite as well. He'd a stick with a horse's head handle, the best that Woolworths could sell. They didn't think much of ocean, with the waves being fiddly and small. No shipwrecks and nobody drowning, nothing to laugh at all. So seeking further amusement, they paid and went to the zoo. There was one old lion called Wally, who lay in a turbulent posture with his head pressed close to boys. And then, without a morsel of fear, Albert took his stick and he poked it in Wallace's ear. It goes on, I can't remember the rest of it just at the moment, but it goes on to see how the lion ate the child. And it's quite funny. If you ever get it on the internet, on YouTube, it's on, you want to listen to it, Charlie.
Okay, amazing that you can recall all that from your brain immediately. Not bad.
Yeah. It's called Albert and the Lion. Albert and the Lion, it's called.
Yeah, it's a rhyme. Frequency, Tony.
Yeah, somebody's recorded it.
Ah, it's not you, okay. Yeah, he's not right on frequency.
It goes on, it's quite funny. It goes on, it's quite long, and it goes on to say that they tried to claim for the child's death on the insurance, and he said the man from the Prudential, that was the classic insurance, English insurance company, called for his tuppence a week, and he paid out the puzzle sum of £2.46, you know, and finishing up, the lion coughs the lad up, he coughs him up, and he goes home. And so the lion, his dad had collected the money off the insurance company, he says, here's a shilling, go and see what the tigers can do.
Very nice.
It's the English black humour.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll remember that, Rod, won't you? Must have bored him to get it. He's probably gone.
Yeah, that's when I pick out my German humour.
There used to be a guy that came on the stage in the old days. He used to go to theatres and he used to have these things called monologues. You must have heard that one, the little yellow idol to the north of Kathmandu, a little marble cross below the town, a broken-hearted woman tends the grave of Macaroo. Have you ever heard that?
No, never. Kathmandu, isn't that in India?
Nepal? Nepal?
Kathmandu.
Nepal.
Ah, Nepal. Ah, Nepal. Okay, yeah, we pronounce it Nepal.
said, the old musical guy that used to do all those monologues on the stage, you know, Albert and the Lion and the, ferry across the, what's his name, the river there, was a guy called Stanley Holloway.
This is English, Doctor. I have never experienced something like that. We never learned that at school, and I'm watching English television, on American television, but only news. Sky News, CBS, CNN, ABC, so I don't know all these guys, sorry.
I'm talking about the 1930s and 40s. They've all been dead for 60 years.
Yeah, but that really wasn't my time.
Yeah. What are you watching, do you watch the BBC, the British Brainwashing Corporation?
That's a good one, okay. British Brainwashing Corporation. Wow, that's a good...
They're very biased. They're all what we call Ramoners. I remember the guy on the television, and he said the decision that the British people took in 1974 to join the European Common Market has now been revoked. You know, the people have voted to come out of Europe. And you should have seen his face, Charlie. It was like he'd lost a thousand Deutschmarks and found a pound, you know. You should have seen the guy's face. It was almost like he was sucking a lemon over.
Yeah. I need a better reception antenna. I'm really suffering from this noise here. Don't know. I'm definitely not used to listen to this noise. So in the recent weeks I was only listening to the SDR radio in your country, but the upload seems to be very poor, and every night more and more people are coming to listen, and most nights there are more than 15 users listening to the SDR radio, and the upload is too slow, so it's getting jerky, and it's always stopping here, so I'm missing some words sometimes in some sentences, and that caused me some problems, so I just switched back to the rig. I can hear you on the rig, no problem at all, but the more sane stations I'm really struggling with, okay. Anyway, how do you receive me tonight, Tony? Is the band working halfway decent, okay?
You're 5 and 8 on the receive antenna with no noise, and you're 5.9 plus 10 on the transmit antenna with the noise round about the 9. So you're 10 dB over the noise on my receive antenna, on my transmit antenna, and you are 7 S points above the noise on my receive antenna.
Oh, that sounds very good, okay. Yeah, that is the big question for me. Is it worth to put up a special reception antenna, ? The thing is, when you compare my signal, I think you just said it, but when you compare your TX, your transmit antenna, to your reception antenna, how many S units are you winning by listening on the reception antennas above the noise threshold? How many S units do you gain?
Well, I've just told you, on the transmit antenna, you are two S points above the noise level. On the receive antenna, you're 5 S points above the noise level. it's a little bit better tonight. Usually, I'm about 4x points back, 4x, let me think, 2, I'm usually 2 to 3x points, like 18 dB, 2 to 3x points better signal to noise ratio on the receive aerial.
Oh, yeah. And that is valid for everyone, yeah? Not only for me.
Yes, that's for everyone. But of course, the northeast one is usually the northeast receive antenna is usually a bit noisy because it's pointing at electric. I don't get as good on the northeast receive antenna because it is pointing at a power distribution station about 2 miles away. I hear you best on the either the southeast or the southwest. They are quite broad, you know. But if you just want to listen to G, I'd just make an EWE. I'd just build yourself an EWE and point it west.